Hi, Rabbi.
Hi, Shell. How you doing?
Oh, am I the only one?
At the moment,
Okay.
sometimes people are running late. Ricky pro will not be here.
Okay.
She is. She went to see her daughter for
Okay.
the weekend.
No problem.
I got a problem here, I think. No, not with any of this. Oh, here's your hoodie.
Shalom, Rabbi Poppy.
Shalom, your hoodie.
And
Good
shalom,
afternoon at this
shalom,
point.
mazel tov, Shelley.
Oh,
When I
likewise.
saw you had 19 grandchildren, I said, my God, to think about how many great grandchildren he's going to have,
Oh, yeah. And mazel tov to you and Brenda
Yes.
as well.
Yes.
That was very exciting.
It certainly was, especially that play on Miriam by naming her middle name Ashura. I never heard that before in my life, but I thought it was cool.
Yeah, Ashir is a lovely name. One of my colleagues.
Also, so you've heard this before.
Yeah,
Okay,
I've heard the
fine.
name
I never
Ashira.
did. That's why, but I thought the connection, Miriam was the name they had to give the child. And the Ashura is what they put in. But the point is, I thought that was pretty smart. I never realized that this had been done before. Good for you.
Yeah, one of our leaders in the rabbinical assembly is Ashira Konigsberg, a young woman who is the daughter of Randall Konigsberg, with whom I was in rabbinical school. He was a few years ahead of me.
Very nice.
And Ashira seems to be doing a
Famo.
very, very good job.
Your famo.
So,
Very, very good to hear
good
something like
name, good name.
that. Yeah, it is. It really is. You know, I like new, ingenious women's names, you know, because there's always people who always complain of a shortage. So there's plenty of very cute women's names in
Yeah.
Tanakh that nobody uses. It's
Oh,
not
and
like as if they're not there, it's just nobody wants to use them, you know. I found I was we were in Brooklyn on our last 2 days of Pesach, and our
hi,
next door
Charlotte.
neighbors, hi Charlotte, how are you?
Yes. Hi, Charlotte.
Very good. Thank you, boys. I have a question, Rabbi.
Wait a minute. Yehudi's
That's all
just
right.
finishing.
Let
Okay.
Charlotte answer the question. I'll just write you the story. It's a
Okay.
cute story.
Go ahead,
Go
Charlotte.
ahead, Charlotte.
I was looking ahead, and I have the Bible or the Eitz Chaim book at home, and I was looking into this portion that we're reading now, and it's one of the Torah portions. It's huge. Is one person going to do it, or are you dividing it up?
No, it's one person's going to do it. Well, those are
It's
again, this is just as at the end of Vayikra, at the end of Leviticus. Here at the end of Devarim, we have the tochecha, the
what is that?
rebuke, or the curses. You know, it's the blessings and curses, the consequences of
Right.
following or not following the Brit. And we generally don't divide up that aliyah, you
It's very,
know?
very, 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 very big, very long.
One aliyah is very big.
Yeah.
Yeah,
It's
why?
not the longest aliyah you can ever have, though. The longest Yeah.
aliyah you can ever have is when Matot Maaseh come out together. And then Shlishi, I think, is 72 verses,
Yeah, it's
you know?
incredibly long.
So
Incredibly
that's
long.
the longest.
Yeah. Actually, and yeah, Kitavo is long. I don't have to worry about it this year, thankfully, because we have this Shabbat celebrating Susie and Joel and Judy Goldman, and Susie's family is going to take care of the Torah reading.
Oh, that's so nice.
Yeah, which
That's
is
good.
great. Well, first of all, it's just wonderful to have them
It
here.
sure is.
And to hear them, and that they can participate for such a wonderful occasion, it's really really wonderful.
Thought we did that once before,
Well,
honoring them.
we did when they left to some extent. We
You
had
should do it every year after what Susie contributed to their show.
yeah.
Yeah,
Well, I'm
every
not
year.
saying that it's bad. I just know that
Well,
we did
now
it once
we are giving
before.
them an honorary lifetime membership. Before it was we just honored them because they were leaving, and now
I
we're
see.
actually
acknowledging that they will be honoring
That's members. Very interesting. Did you ever give anyone else an honorary lifetime membership before?
I think so, but I don't know the history of the congregation.
My shul in Brooklyn will never do that. If I want to be a life member, which I am, I got to pay the regular dues that everybody pays, even if they don't live in Brooklyn. But that's very cute, though. I think it's a precious idea. Yes. You know?
Yeah.
Hi, Rabbi Zucker. How you doing?
Good.
Hi, Rabbi Zucker. How are you?
Good. Good.
Okay. Let's start sharing here. Well, we've been sharing, but let's share the text. Okay. Once again, you know, just so much in this parasha. Is this readable to everybody?
Yes.
Okay, good. There's once again quite a bit in our parasha, as Charlotte brought up already, the whole tochecha, the blessings and curses that are the consequences of observing or not observing the Brit. There are the opening sections, which are declarations that are made for bringing our first fruits. We've talked about that section in the past. It's an important section because it's also the core of the Haggadah. And then we have another section for bringing tithes into Jerusalem. And then we have as well a description of the covenant ceremony that's going to take place when the Israelites enter into the land. And just before that, we have a very interesting section, which in many ways is dealing with the whole idea of the chosen people. Now, on one hand, as we'll see from the language of this section, we've had it before. We've had it back in Shemot, just before the giving of the Torah on Mount Sinai. And to some extent, within the Tanakh, it's kind of clear what the idea of chosenness is. But as we'll see, there are some different perspectives that get added within our commentators. And I'm just looking at stuff on our parasha. I'm not going back to Shemot. I mean, there's much more that I'm not going through Nevi'im. There are all kinds of things that can be written on this, but just an exploration of some of the ideas that pop up and also some modern expressions. Okay, so first of all, let's just read this section. Who would like to begin?
I'll read.
Okay, thank you, Carol.
This day, Hashem, your God, commands you to observe these laws and the regulations. You are to take care and observe them with all your heart and with all your being. Hashem, you have declared today to be for you a God, to walk in his ways and to keep his laws, his commandments and his regulations, and to hearken to his voice.
Okay, now a couple things that you know we've heard before many times in the opening line that v'asit otam, you shall do them b'chol levavcha v'chol nafshecha, and lasot et hachukim et hamishpatim, and here too lalechet bidrachav, to walk in God's ways, again v'lishmor chukav u'mitzvotav u'mishpatim, to listen, keep his laws, commandments. Okay, so let's go on.
And Hashem has declared you today to be for him a specially treasured people, as he promised you, to be careful regarding all his commandments and to set you most high above all the nations that he has made, for praise, for fame, and for honor, for you to be a people holy to Hashem your God, as he promised.
Okay, so here, kind of clearly, statement of chosenness, liot lola am segula, to be for him especially treasured people. Same language we had in Shemot, and also observe his commandments, and we will end up with honor, etc. And but again, liotcha am kadosh l'Adonai Elohecha, to for you to be a people holy to God. And certainly that goes back even to Vayikra. Kedoshim tihiyu, you shall be holy.
Wait a second, Rabbi Papi.
What?
You're making kadosh le to equal just kedoshim tihiyu. That's not the same. Kadosh le means holy too, in the sense of special too.
Especially, yeah.
That's basically what it means, like Karayat Mekudesh, at least the Kabbat Zoo. That's, you know, to go around saying Kedoshim to you, you know, hear what Hashem is saying is that you and I are married. That's basically what term is here. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's sort of nice to say it that way, you know, but is the word, I'm looking at the, but I think there's a poor point to make here, but how many places can you find in the Torah a clear-cut statement that what's going on between Am Yisrael and Hashem is something along the lines of a marriage, the way people like Hosea and Yirmiyahu go full blast, but in the Torah it's just like hinted at here.
More hinted than, yeah. No, absolutely. I just...
At the time of Aseret Hadibrot.
I mean, and certainly we have it at the other end with the Haftarot right now.
Yeah.
Where?
With the Haftarot of...
Yeah, but I asked in the Torah.
Yeah. So, yeah, in the
Torah. Is this the idea in
the air? Or is this an idea that was, you know, Hosea pretty much invented and everybody came up with, okay? Or followed in his path.
Yeah.
You know, my feeling is it was already there. Hosea didn't make it out of whole cloth. You know,
I would agree with you.
It tremendously. You know,
I would agree with you. I think that it is hinted at. And right now, here again, I'm just dealing with this particular passage in Devarim and pointing out similarities to other passages in the Torah. You're right. I just copied the translation of Fox, and he says, "For you to be a people holy to Adonai your God." You know, of course, the word Kadosh means. Way. Pardon me?
He translates the word segula, or Yotam Kadosh, he translates that way. Okay. I didn't quite get it. Okay. I get it now.
To separate, too, which in this day and age, I think that's the only meaning of it we can understand.
Well,
they're separate from the rest of the world.
Agreed. Yeah.
And
there isn't that much difference between Kadosh and Havdalah when you get down to it.
Right.
You know, it's very interesting to discuss that topic.
Yeah, that's an important point because, you know, we usher in Shabbat or we distinguish Shabbat from the weekday at the beginning with Kiddush and at the end with Havdalah. And they're both ceremonies of distinction, of marking as distinct. And the word Kadosh literally means distinct, separate. You know, the Aron HaKodesh, the Holy Ark, is simply a closet. That's where we put the Sifrei Torah. But because we put the Sifrei Torah in there, it's an Aron Kodesh. It's separate. It's separate from the rest of the room. It's distinct. Okay, now let's just take a look at how some of our Mefarshim explain these verses. What I'm presenting today is, again, I'm just sharing with you some of the presentations. I'm not trying to say I necessarily agree with all of them. We'll come to one at the end, which I do not agree with, or that these are the only ways to think about the notion of chosenness, but I think they do point to an idea of chosenness that is a little bit more expansive than we sometimes think of it. Okay. Who wants to go on with Sforno?
I'll read, Rabbi.
Okay, thank you. sorry, thank you, Charlotte.
And Hashem has declared you today by entering into the covenant with you, a distinction he has not accorded to any other nation.
Okay. Yeah, that's pretty clear. Understanding this is, you know, Israel is distinct.
To be for him, so that he may achieve with you what he hoped to achieve with mankind when he created man, saying, let us make man in our image.
Okay, so now what is Sforno entering into this notion of chosenness? Not just that God has chosen everyone. Sorry, let me get out of a few things, so you don't have to listen to my computer.
We're the type of mention that he wanted to create.
Right. That we are, to some extent, created, chosen, but created to be exemplars. And the notion of chosenness is not just a status, but also a mission. And one could find support for that in other biblical texts. In a few weeks, we're going to read the Haftarah for Bereishit, where we have the famous phrase, L'or Goyim. God has appointed the Israelite people as a light to the nations. That is a role of instructing and teaching. It's a mission. Okay. Go on.
To be careful regarding all his commandments.
Yeah, this means really to observe all his commandments.
He accorded you an additional distinction in having chosen you to observe all of his commandments, through which you will find favor in his eyes. To him, the other nations are not prepared or fit for them, as our sages, may their memory be a blessing, said. A Gentile who rests on Shabbat is liable for death. Thus, they are not fit to observe all my commandments. Rather, they limit it to only the seven commandments of the sons of Noah.
Okay, so before we unpack the second part,
really going out on a limb.
Yeah. You know,
liable for death.
I can't say that I agree with everything in all of these statements. But again, it makes one think about some of the expansive ways in which we have understood chosenness. But at the very beginning, I think he's really stating the pshat. What does it mean to be chosen? Just don't think about the other nations right now. Just think about the beginning.
Follow all his laws.
Exactly. What makes us chosen is that we are given the Torah, that we have a unique role to fulfill God's mitzvot that could be attached to that the other missions that may be stated. But first and foremost, we have to follow the mitzvot. And many people have pointed out that really to be the chosen people, we have to be the choosing people. We have to choose to observe God's mitzvot. Go ahead, Yuri.
Well, it's interesting that he's picking out that bit about Gosh Shabbat Chayav Mita, which is the thought of one person or one place, whereas the much more famous and authored and backed up statement in Sifrei that Hashem basically went around and asked all the other nations before he even offered it to us. He offered it to B'nai Esav and offered it to B'nai Moab and offered it to B'nai Ishmael. And we only were offered it after everybody else turned it down. So that's not quite the same as saying that, you know, nobody else ever got offered it in the first place. You know, in other words, if once you go around saying the only reason we've got it because we're the only ones who are prepared to accept it, that's not quite the same choice as the kind of choice where basically it was never offered to anyone else. Like, for example, in a musical, a woman will say, I'll marry the next man who asked me because she's so disgusted with the fact she's gotten to be 35 or whatever, and she's still single. So, you know, the much more mainstream midrash about offering the Torah to lots of nations and then eventually we're the only ones who took it doesn't make us sound as exclusive as this one does. And Gosh Shabbat Chayav Mita is off in space somewhere. I wouldn't even quote something like that in order to show that this is what Judaism thinks.
Yeah.
It's just a bad thing to do, to quote a piece of one person's opinion in one place in an unedited book, basically, and call that chazal. I call that a chaz without the lamed, meaning it just does not representative of what Judaism really is about. We don't have any objection. We would be only too thrilled if the world got decided to turn off their cell phones at Shabbat or something like that, you know, as a result, you know, as a salute. Remember how thrilled we were when Mrs. Starmer said that she, who's Jewish, said that she, you know, makes sure that Kier attends Shabbat meals with the family and stuff of that nature. So even though he's not Jewish, you know, so I mean, in other words, I think we have to be very, very careful when we start thinking about what does it mean. Atah b'char tam recall amen. That's really a rabbinic statement, and you know, yes, it's based on Sefer Devarim, no question about it. But it requires a lot of thought to tease out just precisely what's intended by statements of this nature. You know, I mean, Ora Altman said, "Atah b'char tam recall amen la muta kisei kavodecha." Yeah. Meaning, we are the chosen people. We've suffered more than anybody else.
Yeah.
What is this business about a Gentile who rests?
Wait, before we get to that. So the first part, yeah. I didn't quote this because I think this is a mainstream Jewish position. I'm simply bringing in all these comments of Sforno.
Because no, I didn't say that you think it's
because next time I see Sforno, I'm going to tell him how terrible this is.
No, you're not going to, because he's been out for quite a while.
Yeah, and, I know.
But what I'm saying is, I'm just simply saying that when you read something like this, you have to put your critical faculties together and ask yourself, you know, he's choosing to quote something. It's not really something which is what Judaism believes.
Yeah, and certainly what he mentioned.
Interesting that Sforno comes up with this when you think of his background. He was engaged with teaching.
Absolutely, Christian Hebrews, no question about it.
It's the couple things that are going on. I think first of all, the first part of this statement is much more to the pshat, that we have to observe God's commandments. And he may be thinking about the fact, that midrash that you mentioned in Sifri, well-known midrash, that God peddles the Torah to the other nations of the world, and they're not interested for whatever reason. There still is within our tradition the sense that Judaism is for Jews, and it really shouldn't be observed by non-Jews. And to some extent, I'm thinking about the fact that this appears in rabbinic literature, that, you know, it may reflect a time when Jewishness was not so clear. When you had Christians who were still observing Jewish rituals, and you mean
the Jewish Christians?
Yeah, the Jewish Christians. And there probably were Christians who weren't originally Jewish who were observing Jewish law. There, I think things were a little bit more, a little bit more foggy. And so that may be the background. I have no idea. I mean, I haven't.
This is the Bavli statement, Rabbi Papa.
Yeah.
It's not a Yerushalmi statement.
So, no, but it could.
You know, the Christians weren't really that part of general experience of Amoraim and Bavel. You know, I'm just saying it just, you know, look, as far wants to quote it.
If you look at the Biblical Archaeology Society, they have a volume on Christianity and Rabbinic Judaism.
Which is very good, by the way.
And in that, they indicate, some of the research indicates that really almost up until the advent of Islam, there was a lot of fuzziness, and Christians would attend synagogues and such.
Even in Bavel.
Yeah. And by the way, in terms of, even though
Bavel... Even in Bavel, that was the case.
Yeah, even though Bavel was not... You know, the Jews of Bavel did not have a great connection with the, or much connection with the Christians yet. What's his name? The German scholar. He wrote a very interesting little book, Jesus in the Talmud. And he has a theory that the statements in the Talmud were especially in Bavli because they didn't have to worry about what the Christians thought of them. And that to some extent what the rabbis created was an anti-gospel. I'm not 100% sure he's correct, but nonetheless, the Bavli certainly, you know, whether this is a Bavli tradition or even goes back earlier, I think just the historical background is that there's some people who really want to keep Judaism for Judaism. Just as today, we might find it a little insulting that certain Christian bookstores and Christian sources sell shofarot and talitot and other Jewish religious symbols that Christians are using in their services. So, anyway, let's go on. Keep going. Because, you know, here's some other ideas that he's bringing in about chosenness.
And to set you most high in your ability to understand and to teach, as was said in Exodus 19:6, you shall be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation.
Again, he's bringing in this notion of a holy people. Not so much kedoshim to you, but tem to you li mamlechet kohanim. But what was the role of the kohanim in biblical times?
Teachers.
Right. So again, this is part of the sense of chosenness as mission. We are also supposed to teach. Mm-hmm. And then going on.
For praise, for fame, and for honor for God. May he be blessed, as was said, Isaiah 49:3. Israel, you in whom I glory.
Yeah, so we're also, you know, our existence, our being should also be used as praise for God. Hence, so many, you know, we have throughout our tradition, a dismissal of certain behaviors as being a chilul Hashem, a desecration of God's name, or kiddush Hashem, a sanctification of God's name. You know, our actions somehow, as it were, reflect on God. And again, we have that throughout the Bible as well. And here's, again, something he brings in from left field.
For you to be a people holy to Hashem, your God, eternal for life in the world to come.
Yeah.
As he promised, as was said, you shall be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation.
Yeah. So he brings in a couple of things that are a little out there, but, you know, he comes back to this notion of, as the chosen people, we have a mission. Now, to be chosen means we have to observe the mitzvot. And, you know, through living this way, we are a witness to God's greatness. Well, but a couple of other ideas that get tossed in there as well. Even if we find some of them a little unusual or way out there, not necessarily implied in any way in the biblical text. Who wants to go on now? Just a quick line from Bechor Shor. Any volunteers?
Yep, I'll continue.
Oh, okay, thanks, Shel. And Adonai has
declared you today that he has replaced all the nations of the world with you, for he hates them, and he has chosen you to observe all of his commandments.
Yeah, here's another strain where
that's a bit heavy.
Yeah, that's a bit heavy, and
that's coming from the French days of the Jewish Christian polemic. Before, oh, yeah. Sure, you know, this is around the time, and it's a little bit after the Second Crusade.
Yeah.
You know, feelings were pretty raw at that point.
Yeah. And it's always important to recognize the historical context in which things are said. It may not excuse them, but it puts them into context. We'll see that when we get to some of the modern comments. That also, one in particular, that really reflects a contemporary situation in many ways. I mean, they're not meant as commentaries on this particular text, but just statements about chosenness. Okay, He is Rabbeinu Bechayai.
And Hashem has declared you today. In other words, just as you accepted him as God, so he performed so many miracles on your behalf that as a result, you agreed to view yourself as exclusively his people. God confirmed this at Mount Sinai when he said, if you will surely hearken to my voice and be loyal to my covenant, then you will become a treasured people for me, more so than any other nations.
Yeah, so I think that, you know, here he, Rabbeinu Bechayai, is just, you know, picking up on, you know, when we read the section here in Devarim, we can't help, given the language, but go back and say, yeah, that's what we were told at Sinai. And that was the formation, the real formation of the Jewish people as they enter into the Brit with God. Of course, here at in our parasha, it is a renewal or a new Brit with God. The people who made that Brit at Sinai have all died in the wilderness. And now it's a new people that is about to enter into the land, and they have to reaffirm this Brit, this covenant with God. And again, what is really our role as chosenness? What allows us to be chosen? Not a trick question. What allows us to be chosen? Just the
last vote.
Yeah, as he says right here. There is no distinction for Israel to be called a treasured people except to the observance of the mitzvot. Boom. You know, I mean, that's, I think, very clear and very, very true.
But now, we do sometimes say that we were chosen to get a present that others didn't get, you know, which is certainly part of chosenness, too. It's not just obligations. It's also entitlements or whatever you want to call it. In other words, for example, the Shabbat Kiddush makes it sound like the fact that Hashem chose us was in order to give us the Shabbat. Now, that doesn't mean Geisha Shabbat 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 Mita.
Right.
But it certainly does mean that this was it's a commandment, but the kind of commandment people wish that they would get. In other words, we're always so pleased that basically this commandment has been given to us. And then you go over the whole thing all over again, you know. So that means he gave it to us with love. You know, that was like a wedding present, and I'm not coming up with anything new. This is basically an idea.
Right.
I was taught this as a child. So it's not just obligations, it's also zechuyot.
Yeah, we'll come to that in a moment. But even here, there's a hint of that at the very beginning of Rabbi Bechaya's comment. In other words, just as you accepted him as God, so he performed so many miracles on your behalf. You know, there's the sense that he is doing something for you. And in fact,
celebration certainly makes it sound like the people that Hashem favors, Avram, Yitzhak, Yaakov, and Yosef, are going to, Hashem's going to go to bat for them, even when they get into a sticky wicket of a situation that they're to a large extent to blame for themselves. You know? Which clearly shows that Hashem is favoring them, not just being just towards them. And Hodu boasts about this when we say, in other words, it's very clear that basically being chosen also has an aspect of special favor.
Right. And we'll see that a little even more.
If we can go back just to a moment to the statement of Hazal of the non-Jew observing Shabbat deserves death. Since the mitzvah of Shabbat is to let everyone rest, it's not so simply resting that if a non-Jew rests on Shabbat, that's the violation. It's the possibility that someone would, who's not Jewish, is going to, in effect, recite Kiddush and make it act like as if he were Jewish. Is that really what's...
Probably. Actually, in the I changed the translation because the translation of that was a non-Jew who observes Shabbat, which is a much more total type of thing. And that could very well be it.
So we may be having a polemic here against Judeo-Christians, even against Christianity.
Yeah, I mean, that's why I raised the historical concept. Yeah. Now, it's let's ridiculous. Go on.
That's what I think. Ridiculous.
Well, you know, whatever we think about it, I mean...
Judy, any thoughts?
That's already in Midrash Rabbah, which predates the Christian, I think. In other words, what we see in Vayikra Rabbah and Bereishit Rabbah, I believe, even though it was published very early after the Christian, sort of Christianization of the Roman Empire and Eretz Israel, wasn't written then. So when they talk in that famous Midrash, Amad Vayimodet Eretz Ra'ah Vayater Goyim Vayikra Rabbah, that whole discussion of being obligated to use kosher food, the implication there is that if Hashem tried to basically lay that kind of an obligation on the whole world, they wouldn't be able to stand it, you know? So that doesn't sound like an anti-Christian polemic at all. That essentially is, you might be blowing your own horn, but you're certainly not going around and zapping other religions or beliefs. Yeah. It's really, you know, you're not going to ask people to study physics unless they've already demonstrated a certain amount of ability to study and learn in general. You know, that would be the tone of that kind of a statement. In other words, we've put our shoulder to the wheel, therefore we're going to be asked to do a bit more than somebody who just simply doesn't have the ability, inclination, desire, whatever. But it's not a polemic against another religion.
Right. Although, again, I think that...
this is Vayikra Rabbah on Azoto Chelu in Sparshat Shmini Rabbah Azoto.
Sorry, let me go back to where we should be. Again, I think that it's very difficult sometimes to read our early rabbinic sources, even the later rabbinic sources, and knowing what is really talking about Christianity, what is talking about another group.
It's too easy. Well, remember Rabbi Papio when you said, sometimes a cigar is just a cigar.
Yeah.
It was sometimes when we're talking about what they're trying to say something nice about the Jewish people or Judaism, if they're not clearly making it, saying who they're polemicizing against, you can't necessarily assume that, you know, who they're polemicizing against. They may not be. They may be just going to try to blow their own.
Yeah. You know? A great example, by the way, of what you're talking about, some of the stuff predates Christianity, is the statement that has been excised from most Ashkenazic Sidurim in the Aleinu.
Yes, yeah, so also
they bow down to nothingness. They pray to a God who does not save.
It's not talking about Jesus. The pagan religions.
Right.
Coming straight out of Yeshua or Shani. So who's he zapping there? The
certainly not the Christians.
And the pagans in Babylon.
Yeah.
So it was, yeah, if you're saying that the Jewish way is the best way, by implication, you're zapping something else. But that's not quite the same thing. And I'm going to figure out for you what the target is. That's a totally different thing altogether. And I don't think you have to do that. I don't think you should do it.
No, it's important that, you know, especially today, first of all, anti-Semites do not need any
additional ammunition.
They don't need any additional, but, you know, there's always the claim that, you know, like the Talmud is anti-Christian. Yeah, there are a lot of things that are really anti-Christian in the Talmud. And if it takes 7.5 years to go through the Babylonian Talmud, the anti-Christian stuff would last, what, maybe a week? Maybe.
Not even that long. And a good deal of it has been censored out anyway. It's not in our printed editions. You have to get Steinsaltz or somebody who's going to give it to you in the back or as a footnote.
Okay. Now, here we have from another element of our tradition, from our Musar tradition, Chavot HaLevavot, Duties of the Heart, very, very famous Musar text for Jewish ethics, morality. And here is what he has to say. Go ahead, Shel.
The main thing of all is to complete the conditions of service and to designate God alone with masterhood, that all this be wholeheartedly and faithfully, and through this one's love of God will be wholehearted, and likewise be God's love towards him. As written, you have declared Hashem this day to be your God, and Hashem has declared you this day to be his treasured people.
Yeah, so obviously from our parasha.
And to make you supreme above all the nations that he made. And then all the peoples of the earth will see that the name of the Hashem is called upon you, and they will fear you.
Okay, so what element of chosenness is Chavot HaLevavot making here? I mean, what are they really, you know, what's the emphasis here? It's not the same as, oh yeah, you know, observe all the mitzvot, but I mean, yes, I think that's implied in here, but what's it really, how is it seeing chosenness?
This book was written in Arabic, wasn't it?
What
we're getting
so.
Here is the Hebrew translation and then the secondary English translation of the Hebrew.
Probably. So, I mean, I
doesn't
don't
make too much sense to me, really.
Yeah. You know, but I, you know, here, what I think he's doing, assuming that this is right, is that the wholehearted and faithfully, after all, this is coming out of Chavot HaLevavot.
It's not the number one book of Jewish thought, though. It's far from it. It's more Muslim.
No, I'm not pretending.
I put it in a category of Mesilat Yisharim rather than the category of Moreno Vuchim, which is where it's usually taught.
Yeah. But the point is that here, what's being emphasized is relationship. That the relationship with God, the sense of devotion and commitment to God, and that, you know, it's somewhat, you know, one's love for God will be wholehearted and likewise will be God's love towards him. That it's about relationship here, the chosenness, very much like the idea of chosenness, when Hare at mikudeshet li, behold, you are separate, distinct to me. And then we say the wedding, like the chosenness of bride and groom. He's not saying that directly, but he is emphasizing chosenness as a sense of relationship and commitment. And to some extent, you know, that's what we have structured in the structure of the Shema. Remember, the Shema in our tefillot is not just the three paragraphs from the Torah, but it's surrounded, those three paragraphs are surrounded by brachot, and the bracha in the morning and in the evening that immediately precedes the Shema is either Ahava Rabba'a of Tanu, you have loved us with great love, or Ahavat Olam Beit Yisrael Amcha Ahavta, you have loved the house of Israel, your people, with complete love. You know, God loves us. And then what do we read in the first paragraph of the Shema? V'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha. There's a mutuality of affection there.
Very good, Rabbi Papi. That's an excellent point.
Yeah, and you know, and we'll see now that there are a number of texts that focus less on the observance of the mitzvot, although certainly these authors totally have in mind that observing the mitzvot is the way one shows love of God. You know, I don't want to.
I think you're putting an emotional element to it that in the original context of the Shema and its comparison with the Esharden treaty, vassal treaties, is not there. You're obligated.
Yeah, they didn't know that, Rabbi Zucker. Yeah. You think they knew that this was something?
And I was talking about how we structured.
Rabbinically, absolutely agree.
You know, there's no way that Chazal could have possibly realized that this was simply a frame type of phrase that was taken from Esach Adon Vassal. Yeah. That's great.
As we've mentioned before, that Chesed, Ahava, these are terms implying loyalty in Sefer Devarim. But as we get to rabbinic literature and the structure of the Siddur,
No question. Certainly, at that point, yes, absolutely.
Yeah. So now let's go on to Hasidic literature, which is certainly mystical. This is Ben Porat Yosef, by one of the major disciples of the Baal Shem Tov, Yaakov Yosef of Polonia. And here's what he has to say. Somebody else want to continue? You know, whoever's read before can continue if you'd like.
I'll read.
Okay, thank you, Carol.
That which is written, which Hashem commanded me to say to you, to say has two meanings. Hashem, you have declared today, is an expression of praise and uniqueness. It is also possible to explain it as an expression of thought, as is written. Haman said in his heart, in Esther 6:6.
Yeah, so they're using the same word, you know, amar, the same root. And what he's just saying, oh, we can understand this as, you know, literally saying.
You didn't comment on that, Rabbi Papi, but there is a problem. There's no other place in the whole Tanakh where the word amar is used in a hiphil. And it's perfectly legit for a commentator to try to figure out what that signifies.
Yeah, I should have mentioned that. That's a weird, I mean, I always found that a weird word, and it is. And they repeat it. Amarta, Amircha, okay.
Yeah, but that's it. In other words, nobody else ever uses the term that way. And, you know, I've seen attempts to explain it in a sense of you're standing tall from the word Amir, which is the top of the tree, you know.
Uh-huh.
Amir. But, I mean, you know, that's cute. I have no idea if there's any real basis for it.
Yeah,
Arabic supposedly has a meaning of to command or something along that line. So, I would welcome something from your, you know, if you're going to basically put it out here, then maybe you have something to say about it on your own.
I the translations are, what do we have, which is commanded me to say to you today, or
that's,
you know,
based on the Arabic.
Yeah, you know, and Adonai has declared you today. That's the word, that's Fox's translation. But it's weird. What does it mean, declare you today? That's odd. In the English, certainly. So
you say you put it on top, you know, that works, you know, both ways, because you put Hashem on top and he's putting you on top in the sense of you're special to him.
Yeah, and somebody else translated as summoned.
I don't see the ayah here. I don't know what the whole problem was with the word lemor.
The word is not with lemor.
Amar. Lamir.
Yeah, it's not this.
JPS has affirmed.
Yeah. So here, the comment is on the word lemor. It's just on the word lemor.
Yeah.
But we just commented on the fact, as kind of a sidelight, that the word, which seems to have the same root as lemor, up here, you know, katuv et Adonai ha'amarta hayom. V'Adonai ha'emircha hayom. Those are odd forms.
Right.
And, you know, exactly how to translate them, or I wouldn't even translate them. I mean, how to understand them is not entirely clear.
Well, one thing that would work with it is it means that one, two people are making declarations and commitments towards each other, which, again, sounds like a marriage type of
situation. Yeah, mm-hmm, exactly.
Okay.
So let's go on with what Ben Porat Yosef, with Yaakov Yosef of Polonia has to say. You know, say has two meanings. Hashem, you have declared today as an expression of praise and uniqueness. But it's also possible to explain it as an expression of thought. Haman said in his heart, go on, both explanations.
Both explanations are true, for they need each other. That which is written, this is what Hashem commanded me to say to you, is to grant praise and uniqueness through connection of my thoughts to you, to raise you up for praise and glorification, as was written. When Moshe would raise his hand, Israel would be victorious over all the nations. If so, the plain meaning is also true, which Hashem commanded me to say to you, so that you also bind your thoughts to me, to take hold of the hand of your father, your teacher. This is also good.
Yeah, I wasn't sure how to translate. Is it V'iti Shapir? V'ati Shapir? I wasn't quite sure how to translate that. I'm pretty sure it's V'ati Shapir.
Yeah,
but I just wasn't quite sure how to translate that. But it here,
works out well.
Yeah, it works out. Yeah, that's a good one. So on one hand, God is granting praise and uniqueness. And that to some extent is the idea of uniqueness, of chosenness. But it's also this last part, so that you bind your thoughts to me, that there's a meeting of the minds, literally. And you take hold of the hand of your father, your teacher, your father. Yeah, it's talking about relationship. Now, it's not marriage here, but parent-child is also a relationship to some extent of chosenness and love. And that they're also emphasizing here. And going back to this idea of love, chosenness through love, is, you know, how do we view the Torah? The Torah is God's gift to the Jewish people. It's, if you will, the ring in the marriage ceremony. It doesn't have to be a ring, you know, anything of value, but certainly the Torah is of great value. God gives the Torah, HaBocher Be'amo Yisrael Bi'ahava, who chooses his people Israel in love. And what's that love? He gives his Torah.
You should know, Rabbi Bakhti, that Sayagon Siddur doesn't even have the word Bi'ahava. Basically, that was added on later. Originally, there were two brachot, Ohev Amo Yisrael and HaBocher Be'amo Yisrael, which meant the exact same thing in two different words. Hmm. In other words, later on, somebody began to think that the love is not there, so they put in HaBocher Be'amo Yisrael Bi'ahava. But the history of Tefillah shows that this was just two different ways of saying the same thing, like Emet B'Emunah or Emet B'Yatziv, or this type of thing. In other words, it wasn't intended to express a different kind of thought. When you choose, it means you love.
Yeah.
And so, when you love, you choose who you love.
Yeah. So that's, you know, again, the sense of relationship. And we see it here as they draw on wonderful teaching. I'm going to just go through this quickly. This is from Nefesh HaChayim. I think it was Chaim of Volozhin, I think.
The Chaim of Volozhin. You're getting into really
just checked. Steinsaltz translates Hamirta as "you have elevated."
Huh, interesting. Going with the word Hamir to top.
Okay, I want to go on because I want to get to some of the modern readings, not necessarily that I agree with them. Actually, let's go to them because this next part is basically getting into the whole wonderful story of really the mutuality of relationship between God and Israel. There's a great story of the fact that God wears tefillin. So they ask the question, what's written in God's tefillin? You know, we know what's written in our tefillin, it's the Shema. What's written in God's tefillin? Who is like your people, Israel, a singular nation, for it was a great nation. So that's part of it I didn't finish correcting this paragraph, so it's all right. But basically, it's the same thing. It's this mutuality of love. Now, of course, the tefillin are a mitzvah, and they remind us to observe the mitzvot. So we're never getting away from the notion that the way we show our love for God, the way we show our chosenness, is choosing to fulfill God's mitzvot. That's still the foundation of chosenness, but there's a whole emotional content that begins to be added to the tradition. And we can see some of these ideas in the statements of a number of rabbis. I just chose these because I happen to have these. Some of you may remember there was a wonderful book or a collection from Commentary Magazine, The Condition of Jewish Belief, that was done in the 60s.
One of the guys says, what I smoke or not means more to me than whether I'm Jewish or not.
Yeah.
The infamous line that came out of that.
Yeah. But there are, it's a very good book in that it's a tamtzit, kind of like a concentration of of major Jewish thinkers. Well, that was great for the 60s and dealing with issues of the 60s. But also, but in the 90s, I guess the 90s, I think they did a new version, which isn't quite as good, but still useful, because they opened it up to not just white American males, white American Jewish males, but to a lot more people, which makes it a little bit more interesting. And I think these may be taken from there. And so I have chosen conservative or conservative-ish rabbis. The first one, I have to begin with Rabbi David Blumenthal, is a great scholar of Jewish thought who sadly just passed away this week. So I, you know, just in his memory, I felt it was important. So who would like to read Rabbi Blumenthal's statement?
God chose the Jewish people for this revelation. Oh, God has made the divine presence known to others and is in covenant with all humanity, as the tradition teaches. This chosenness is for closeness and intimacy. It is not a license for superiority or inferiority. It does, however, excite jealousy. Jealously.
That should be jealousy, jealousy. Right.
There is not much remedy for that except understanding and humility.
Okay, so what is his point here?
We don't say that we're tops.
Right. Well, it's
like everybody else.
Yeah, we have a unique relationship with God, but we're not the only people who are in relationship with God.
Right.
All humanity, which, you know, goes back to the Tanakh. And, you know, but also acknowledge that just because this idea has a particular meaning doesn't mean that everyone understands it. And that's certainly been true. Okay, and this Rabbi Nina Beth Carden, who is one of my classmates at the seminary.
I believe that God chooses the Jewish people in the same way that a loving parent chooses a child. Every child is endowed with unique qualities that he or she alone can bring to the world. A loving parent will choose,
choose
to encourage the child in accordance with the child's abilities. This is both good for the child and good for the world. Jews have the unique gifts of Torah, of the prophets, of a rich textual, legal, liturgical, ritual, and spiritual traditions. We have the gift of believing that we are partners with God in the world. We have the gift of endless, if sometimes shaky, hope. We have the gift of community. We have a vision of a world without need, without strife, of a world that is all Shabbat. We have a map that guides our path toward this vision, with station stops along the way, mitzvot and holidays, that nourish us so that we do not give up.
And again, here is the gifts that, you know, it's not chosenness also means we get, there's benefit for us. There are beautiful things that we have. But again, emphasizing uniqueness, but not superiority. Okay, and now from David Weiss Halivni, Alav Shalom, one of the great Talmudists of the 20th century. Lovely man, too.
I believe that nations are sometimes chosen, just as individuals are chosen. One can say, for example, that Shakespeare was chosen to give his work to the world. The Greeks, in a sense, had a certain function and were chosen. Chosen in the sphere of religion and morality. These are the areas in which the Jews have contributed to the world at large, and therefore they are chosen. If by chosen we mean that people make a specific contribution, which is not shared to the same extent or equaled by others.
Yeah. So again, one of the things that's shared by all of these and will be shared by the last one is that there's not a sense of superiority. There's a sense of uniqueness. And now we come to one of my teachers, Rabbi Arthur Green, who is a character, to say the least,
Glad you said that, Rabbi Pop.
Yeah. He's a great teacher. I love so many of the things that he has written. I don't necessarily agree with him. In fact, I don't on a lot of things, but, you know, I think that he has in many ways often a deep understanding of Judaism, if a little bit off.
He's also gone off the deep end.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You use the word deep.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think that's clear. He's an older gentleman and unfortunately has not been behaving appropriately in his old age.
I am not a liberal affirmer of Jewish chosenness. It is we who proclaimed ourselves chosen, not God. If you by chosen, you mean vocation. However, I do believe that the Jewish people has a specific mission as indicated above. We have a unique relationship with the One based on our key experience, idea of the human as God's image. Our distinctive role today, as always, is to teach that message, chiefly by example.
Okay, so right there, you can see he's trying to have his cake and eat it too. You know, he doesn't believe in chosenness, and yet he goes on to talk about, yeah, we can say the Jewish people are chosen. He's very much a follower of Mordechai Kaplan in the sense that Mordechai Kaplan rejected the notion of chosenness. And I would say that a lot of that comes from the fact that that became a negative against the Jewish people. As Rabbi Blumenthal said, not everybody understood it. And, you know, what can we do? Now we come in to see what is the context, the historical context in which a Rabbi Green is speaking. You know, this is so clearly, you know, he is, that's why I think this is like in the 90s, because it's just after the first Intifada. Go on.
Therefore, such matters as how prisoners are treated in Israeli jails, how the rights of the Arab minority are handled in Israel, and how our community reacts to incidents of wife beating in our midst go to the very heart of Jewish existence and meaning. These are not liberal values taken from some extraneous source, but rather testing grounds for our fulfillment of our deepest and most essentially Jewish purpose.
Yeah, I think, you know, certainly he's just picking up on some of his, quote, liberal values. But the last sentence is in many ways very important. And I wish so many Jews understood it. You know, they're not liberal values taken from extraneous source, but rather testing grounds for our fulfillment of our deepest and most essentially Jewish purpose. The values of Judaism are the values of Judaism. And they're the ones that drive us, or should drive us, I would say. You know, it's not the editorial page on the New York Times, especially not these days, but, you know, for a long time. That's, you know, they're not just general liberal values. And in fact, we just have to look at the world today and know that these values are not necessarily general liberal values. But, you know, for all his rejection of chosenness, I think he makes some important statements here that, you know, we have a mission and we have to understand that our values and our mission comes from us. It doesn't come from the outside. So, you know, whatever else he may say and a lot of other things that I disagree with, you know, I think there's still something positive in what he says here. It would not be my first choice for describing the chosenness idea in Judaism. So
I think the Tanakh's idea of chosenness is different than the way the rabbis present it in Tefillah. But Tanakh really does seem to think what it means is the side of it is obligation.
Yes.
Whereas the Tefillah makes it sound like the side of it is privilege. And that's not really what the Tanakh believes.
Yeah. So I think, you know, as we saw at the very beginning, that, you know, the connection to, well, and back to Sinai, you know, it's said in Shemot, that our, chosenness is choosing to observe the mitzvot. But there's also, you know, I think from our spiritual side, it's nice to hear that it's also part of a relationship. Relationship is key in Judaism, relationship with others, with the relationship with God. Okay, Toda Rabba, everybody. Shabbat Shalom. Be well.
Thank you.
Stop that. And.